Peace and blessings to you, beloved. I welcome you to a program designed to bless the revealer of secrets and the master of divine mysteries, Jehovah, Yahweh, Yeshua, Jesus. Someone once said words to this effect, that without miracles, without signs and wonders, Christianity or the Messianic faith would just be another religion. This statement is one that you could meditate on. Let me repeat it. Without miracles, signs, and wonders, Christianity would just be another religion. But let me qualify this statement by saying that the true Jewish faith, which is known as Christianity, requires the reality of a supernaturally circumcised heart spoken of in the book of Ezekiel. It requires the reality of a supernatural, born of the Spirit, the Ruach, experience. Therefore, without the miraculous realities contained within the Hebrew Scriptures, the miraculous conception and virgin birth of the Messiah, the miraculous divine blood of Calvary, and the Messiah's miraculous, astonishing, staggering, electrifying resurrection. Without them, the Jewish faith known as Christianity would indeed be just another pseudo-toothless religion. But let me say that God is God, whether he chooses to demonstrate his supernatural deity or not. But aren't you glad that he delights to amaze us? Aren't you glad that Clark Kent indeed really is Superman? Isn't it wonderful that the Messiah didn't arrive on the scene with just a wonderful message of good news? Isn't it awesome that he didn't just give comforting words of reassurance or make profound statements of wisdom? Aren't we grateful that he didn't just tell us about the awesomely magnificent realities of his kingdom? Though to all of this we could all say, Dayenu, meaning this alone would be enough. But no, God with us, the Messiah, the Mashiach, proceeds to demonstrate his deity supernaturally. Who would want a God who couldn't blast open the gates of heaven and perform dazzling, mind-altering feats of power anyway? Let's admit it. We all hung on the edge of our seats for Clark Kent to reveal himself as Superman, especially when he was with Lois. But let's look a bit closer now at the facts. For 3 years, the good Lord performed miracles, signs, and wonders before the new covenant was cut. In other words, the Messiah healed and delivered before the crucifixion and before the resurrection. Signs and wonders weren't news to the children of Israel or the religious of that day. The miraculous intervention of God was quite normal. Just read about the spectacular feats which God did through Moses, Moshe, and Elijah, Eliyahu. The miraculous was woven throughout the Hebrew faith, a very Jewish thing. Now, this was nothing new. But what was new was the Messiah's statements about his true identity God with us. And then he enforces this truth by performing miracles over and above what they were used to in that day. Yeshua Jesus said in Yochanan, John, chapter 10 and verse 38, "If I do not do the works of my Father, do not believe me." That's quite a message to us as his disciples. Anybody can talk, beloved. The Hebrew scriptures, the Tanakh, are filled with massive exploits of divine intervention. This is not just a new covenant reality. Take, for instance, the old covenant pre-resurrection scenario in John, Yochanan, chapter 5. According to the Torah, the law, Yeshua, Jesus, like every good Hebrew man, went up to Jerusalem, Yerushalayim, for the Passover, Pesach. First, we see the Old Covenant provision for the miraculous. For at the pool of Beit Chasda, commonly known as Bethsaida, there lay a great multitude of sick people. They were blind, they were lame, they were paralyzed, and they were all waiting for the moving of the water. But why were they waiting? Because they were expecting the supernatural. There weren't any questions about God's desire to provide healing for them under the older covenant, I might add. No, they knew this was the Lord's divine intention and intervention for his people from heaven. The word tells us in verse 4 that an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. But let's stop right there. Here it is, the Passover, Pesach, Old Covenant provision, and an angel, a divine being visiting earth to stir the pool at an appointed feast. And why? So that whoever stepped in first, after the stirring of the water, was made well of whatever diseases he had. Whatever disease, cancer, AIDS, paralysis, arthritis, whatever, it didn't matter. The angel is here, he's stirring the water, and I need to jump in. Logical. Understood? Yes, but nevertheless, miraculous. Divine intervention. Normal, regular, expected old covenant stuff. So normal, in fact, that a certain sick man hung out there 38 years, year after year. Why so insistent? Because he knew that God healed, and he knew that God wanted to heal, and he knew how. In this case, of course, it was different. The Messiah, God in the flesh, was about to take the old covenant healing provision to another level, off the charts, with or without the pool or the angel. When Yeshua saw him there and knew that he already had been in the condition a long time, he said to him,
"Ata rotze lihyot bari?"
Do you want to be made well? The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me." Yeshua said to him,
"Kum, kach את משקפך והתהלך.
Rise, take up your bed and walk. And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. And that day was Shabbat, the Sabbath. The Judeans therefore said to him who was cured, It is the Sabbath. It is Shabbat. It is not lawful for you to carry your bed. Notice, the healing was not the issue, but the day. A few verses later, the healing was not the issue again, but carrying his bed was. And further on in Scripture, healing again was not the issue, but the identity of the man who healed him. When God told Ezekiel to prophesy against the shepherds of Israel, one of the things he said was, "The weak you have not strengthened, nor have you healed those who were sick." Once again, healing was an expected provision from God. There are many other Old Covenant scenarios, but what is the point that I'm trying to make? That the miraculous healings, signs, and wonders were an older covenant reality. So the question is today, if we have a better covenant, and we do, with better promises, and we do, how much more of this supernatural reality should we expect? The answer is obvious. And if we embrace it, the Clark Kents of Christianity will emerge from the telephone booth, the prayer closet, ready to demonstrate the awesome deity of our God in signs, wonders, and the miraculous. Look, up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's Superman!